Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us this evening for this virtual event focused on the U.S. economy under a Biden-Harris administration. My name is Rohit Kirpalani, and I'm with South Asians for Biden. South Asians for Biden is a national grassroots organization dedicated to engaging and mobilizing the South Asian community to elect Joe Biden and Kamala Harris this November. The South Asian community is a pivotal voting bloc, and make no mistake, our community's ability to organize and turn voters out to the polls this November will be crucial to securing a victory for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris this November. We at SAB are excited about this event, and we are grateful to have these highly accomplished panelists here with us this evening, and for the opportunity to educate and inform voters on how and why a Biden-Harris administration will be better for the health of the American economy. It is noteworthy that just last week, the chief economist at Goldman Sachs said in his report to investors that if the Democrats sweep into power, i.e. there's a blue wave, it would sharply raise the probability of a fiscal stimulus and Biden's longer-term spending plans on infrastructure, climate, healthcare, and education will result in a substantially easier U.S. fiscal policy, a reduced risk of renewed trade escalation, and a firmer global growth outlook. He is not alone. Moody's Analytics has concluded that Biden's economic proposals, if enacted, would create 7.4 million more jobs than would Trump's. So without further ado, let me introduce you to Sonal Shah, the moderator of today's panel. Sonal is an economist and is the founding executive director of the Beek Center for Social Impact and Innovation at Georgetown. Sonal sits on the Economic Policy Task Force of the Biden-Sanders Unity Task Force. And previously, she was a member of the Obama-Biden Transition Project and was head of Global Development Initiatives, a philanthropic arm of Google. Sonal will introduce the other panelists and will guide the discussion this evening. Thank you very much, Sonal, for agreeing to moderate this panel, and I turn it over to you now.
Rohit, thank you for your leadership. Thank you for everything that you're doing for South Asians for Biden. Really, really appreciate all of the work that you and Sanjui have done. It's incredible to see just the teamwork and frankly, the leadership in our community. So thank you for everything. Thank you all for joining. It's such an important time, such an important election. Rohit gave you some really great background on the Goldman Sachs report as well as the Moody's report. We are going to have an incredible panel here that is going to talk about various parts of the economy, everything from international to our domestic policies to how immigration fits into it. So how do we invest in technology? How do we invest in the next generation to what's going to happen with the environment? So looking forward to this incredible panel and group that we will be talking to. Just a note, the Biden-Harris administration, when you look at the economic policies, it is really about growing the economy for everybody. It's not just about growing the economy for capital, but growing the economy where people get jobs, people get to make investments in their communities, people get to be a part of their communities. And that starts with three things. One, addressing the crisis. It is a health crisis that is caused an economic crisis, and it is about addressing the health crisis so we can also reopen our economy. It's not about shutting down the economy, it's about giving clear guidance. It's about making sure there's testing available, it's about making sure there's PPEs available, it's making sure that we can reopen our schools and our businesses in a safe and consistent manner, and that there's clear guidance from the federal government as to how this is done. It is imperative that we do that. In this crisis, almost 400,000 small businesses have collapsed in the wake of the Trump administration's ongoing failure to manage the current crisis. 20,000 in the restaurant industry, 17,000 in the retail shopping industry, 6,500 bars, nightlife industry, 5,000 in the beauty industry, 2,600 in the fitness industry. This is a it is a financial crisis. It is a economic crisis that has been caused by this health crisis, and we have to address that. That is the first thing the Biden-Harris administration will do. The second is also investing in the economy. We have not had an infrastructure bill. The president has promised an infrastructure bill. We haven't done an infrastructure bill in 4 years. There's never one even been introduced. Now, if we're going to introduce infrastructure, we also need to introduce environmental standards that come with that, because we can invest in the future of this country and the future of this economy, the future of a global economy actually is climate, and that the U.S. should be at the front and the forefront of. So that is about building jobs. It is about increasing manufacturing here in the United States. It is making sure that the U.S. government, which is one of the largest buyers of goods and services, buys American, so we can increase production here in the United States. It is about investing in the care economy, those that take care of our children and those that take care of our elders, and making sure we're creating jobs and jobs that are good paying jobs for those communities. It is about making sure that we put racial equity at the core and making sure that we make the system fair so everybody can participate, not just a few people that can survive. So we have a lot to talk about today, but it is my honor and my pleasure to first introduce our first speaker, Raja Krishnamurthy. Congressman Krishnamurthy is from Illinois' 8th District. He succeeded Tammy Duckworth, who became senator. He is on the chair of the Oversight Committee for Economic and Consumer Policy. He's on the Intelligence Committee. He's the Assistant Whip for the Policy Committee. He is a small business. He has run a small business. He's been on infrastructure, Social Security, and Medicare, and education. He is a Princeton graduate and a Harvard graduate. Congressman Krishnamurthy, it's such an honor to have you here. You've been a real leader, not just for the South Asian community, but also for your community in Illinois. So thank you for joining us. Could you talk to us a little bit about how Congress is looking at the economic crisis and the economy and the health crisis, and tell us, what are you looking at from a congressional perspective?
Well, thank you so much, Sonal. Can you hear me? Okay, great. It's great to be with you. I wanted to say a special thank you to Rohit, of course, you, and all the organizers tonight, and my fellow panelists, including Nisha, Shashi, Reshma, Priya, and Tamina. Thank you. It's an honor to be with you. I want to begin by saying I echo your sentiment about the mismanagement and ineptitude with regard to the health crisis in front of us. I think it can't be overemphasized that this health crisis is really driving our economic crisis. And because of that, until we get the health crisis under control, we won't be able to really unleash the full economic potential of our economy. And that's something that we key in on repeatedly in Congress. As you know, we've put forward various programs, including the CARES Act, which helped to successfully start to resuscitate the economy. However, we need much more because, as you know, unfortunately, the healthcare crisis has once again reared its ugly head in an even bigger surge in this fall. As a consequence, the economy is slowing down. We have 10 million people unemployed. We have state and local governments which are on the verge of laying off millions of more people or raising taxes or cutting services or all of the above. We have businesses and entire industries that are on the verge of collapse. 40% of restaurants are about to close their doors in the next 6 months without any further aid from Washington. The hospitality and hotel industry is facing massive foreclosures, and the airline industry has run out of all assistance from the federal government and is about to lay off tens of thousands of more people. So with that, what we propose in Congress is an extension of the CARES Act, but something along the lines of what the Biden-Harris team is suggesting. So for instance, making sure that the payroll protection program, also known as PPP for small businesses, is targeted at not just the large small businesses with connections to the banks, but also the smallest small businesses, including those with less than 50 people. It's very important that they get access to loans. Another important aspect of this is student debt. You know, our young graduates and millennials are taking it on the chin once again in this recession, just as they did in the last Great Recession. They were the first to be laid off then, and they've been laid off once again. And so I agree with the Biden-Harris team that we should forgive at least $10,000 of their student debt, since the federal government holds most of that student debt itself. And that is another way to help jumpstart the economy. Finally, one thing I would just emphasize is in Congress, we see the president failing to use the authorities at his disposal right now to help deal with the healthcare crisis more effectively and jumpstart the economy. So for instance, this president fails to use the Defense Production Act, also known as the DPA, to order the production of PPE, to order the production of more ventilators and all the other materials and testing equipment necessary to solve the healthcare crisis. So those are some of the things that we in Congress desperately believe the federal government needs to do. And under a Biden administration, I believe it would be done.
And Congressman, I know that you all actually passed a bill in Congress from the House side, and it went to the Senate. Can you give us a little bit of what's happened and why did those negotiations stall?
Yes, one word, Twitter. Basically, Speaker Pelosi and Secretary Mnuchin have been in talks with regard to another stimulus package, and we believe that they were very close to signing this particular deal about a week ago. But unbeknownst to the negotiators, the president took to Twitter while they were negotiating and basically called the negotiations off. And of course, what that does is it really causes folks in his caucus, both in the Senate and the House, to back away from further negotiations for fear that they're going to be undercut by their own president. And with the elections coming up in 19 days, not that I'm counting, essentially these folks are very concerned that if they negotiate in good faith with the Democrats, that they will be essentially torpedoed by their own president, and that would hurt them with their base in the upcoming elections. So that is a real problem right now.
So basically we're playing politics with people's lives and their businesses in the meantime.
You must be shocked.
Can you give us a little bit, I've been always baffled why is there this myth that Republicans are better for the economy than the Democrats? Like, you hear this in our community on a constant basis. Can you help us please shed some light on this and why? How do we break out of this myth?
Sure. I think there's a glossy appeal to saying that you're going to lower taxes and lower regulation and have smaller government, and that helps the economy. But actually, the statistics don't bear that out. And in fact, each time the other side talks about this, I think they go against the data. So just as an example, study after study shows that under Democratic presidents, since 1947, the GDP has grown faster, and the stock market even has grown faster than under Republican presidents, even when you exclude the time of COVID, and even when you exclude the time of the Great Recession, which were presided over by Republicans. Now, you might be wondering, why is that? Why is it the case that under Democratic administrations, the economy and stock market actually do better? And why is it that Moody's and Goldman Sachs, hardly liberal Democratic institutions, would think that the Biden-Harris plan would be better for our economy? It's very simple. It's that Democratic administrations tend to invest more in people, education, and infrastructure when they come into office versus Republican administrations. Now, why is that important? Well, when you invest in people, such as in workforce development or jobs tax credits, if you invest in education, if you invest in infrastructure, every dollar that you put in those buckets has a greater multiplier effect than if you were to simply give a tax cut to somebody who perhaps wasn't asking for it and didn't need it. And so the result is, when you have that money going into infrastructure, for instance, it yields more jobs, it yields more spending, because when you invest in roads and bridges and highways and clean energy infrastructure, you hire more people to do that work. It creates a more productive economy that allows people to get their goods and services to their destinations faster. And it allows us to be more competitive, because remember, we are in a global marketplace. This isn't just, you know, Illinois competing against Indiana or Virginia competing against Maryland. It's America competing against the likes of China and other countries. And therefore, it's paramount that we invest in these three things at the least: education, infrastructure, and people, for our economy to really reach its full potential.
And one question that came in from our audience, so I just wanted to make sure, I know you have to leave at 7:30, so I want to make sure we catch your, well, this one question. For those that who are struggling and are hoping that there is a some package that comes out, which I don't think there will be until next year, unless the president really wants to come to the table, what do they do? How are they going to get through? Like, I know lots of people are up for, you know, there's evictions, their eviction notices going out. I'm in Texas. I know how many are going out right now. What do people do?
Well, first of all, you're absolutely right. We should have we should put politics aside for a few minutes and actually try to get a stimulus package done. Last I heard, there were discussions even today between Secretary Mnuchin and Speaker Pelosi. So I'm still somewhat hopeful, but it partly depends obviously on the president and whether he is somebody who is simply going to say yes to a stimulus package. All that being said, for those who are in that situation that you're talking about, I would offer two resources. One, please contact me and my office. We will try to help you in any way, shape, or form. For those who are out there, you can always call me at 847-413-1959, and we will help anyone anywhere from any part of the country. We don't care where you live. If you need help, we will try to be there for you. Secondly, there are certain provisions that extend through the rest of the year, including unemployment benefits, though not at the enhanced status that I would like to see. And they extend through the rest of the year, thanks to the CARES package. The eviction moratorium does last through the end of the year. However, we would like to see it extend through the rest of the pandemic, and also to give landlords relief from the banks, by the way. It's not just about the tenants. We need to take care of the landlords because, you know, they also need to meet their mortgage payments. So those are some of the things that I would offer, but please contact me. You can go to my website. I'm the only Raja in Congress. So you can find me very simply, and we will help you any way, shape, or form.
Congressman Krishnamurthy, I'm going to bring in Nisha Biswal into this conversation. Nisha was the Assistant Secretary of State for Asia. She is currently the president of the U.S.-India Business Council, and he's a friend, and I feel like we've worked together for so many years and been friends for so many years that it's odd to introduce her sort of officially when you want to introduce her personally, too. Nisha, I want to bring you in also on this conversation from a global perspective. Congressman mentioned talked about China, and I'd like to talk a little bit about trade. I mean, this is very much a part of our economic policy. Trade is critical. What's happened on the trade agenda that you both have seen, and maybe you could give us a little bit on what's happening with the trade agenda right now?
Sure. Thank you, Sonal. It's wonderful to be here with Congressman Krishnamurthy and with all of our panelists in a very important discussion that we're having this evening. I would just say trade is such an important aspect of the American economy. Trade is responsible for about 40 million American jobs. And, you know, trade has been responsible for economic growth and growth in manufacturing over these last several decades. And yet what we saw was a Republican administration that came in and essentially started to dismantle all of our trade agreements. We've seen a real, you know, war on trade, even in terms of trade with some of our closest friends and allies. And instead of seeing a boost in jobs, a boost in manufacturing, what we've seen is the opposite. We've seen that we've lost manufacturing jobs, that jobs have not come back. And even when operations have come back, there's been so much automation that it hasn't really resulted in new jobs. Now, I think the Democratic approach to trade agreements has been to try to make sure that there is a higher fidelity on labor and environmental standards. And that there is a focus on trade capacity building and trade facilitation so that the negative impacts of trade, because obviously there are certain sectors that may feel a negative impact, that you are then investing in worker retraining, that you are investing in helping to upskill those workers into new occupations. But what we've seen in the last several years is really an approach to trade that has been not only harmful for our global partners, but it's been actually harmful for the American worker, for the American small business owner, for the American entrepreneur, et cetera. And so I think, you know, what we would want to see and what we will see in a Biden-Harris administration is a return to the negotiating table, a return to a more constructive approach to ensure that our standards are ones that we are infusing into our trade agreements, but also understanding that America leads when America engages globally. And so, you know, conversations that were essentially sent adrift, like the Trans-Pacific Partnership and TTIP, are conversations that we need to reanimate and look not only at the regional blocs, but also the bilateral agreements with emerging economies like India, which is a huge opportunity that we should be pursuing with much more vigor.
Congressman Krishnamurthy, what have you seen from Congress? Has Congress been engaged on trade, or what's happening?
Yeah, you know, obviously the executive branch has a lot of discretion with regard to trade and foreign policy. However, at the end of the day, any agreements need to come before us for our approval. And so that's why we were glad to work to improve the initial framework agreement with the U.S.-Mexico Free Trade Agreement update. And there, I have to say that it really required a lot of give and take and bipartisan negotiations to come up with a deal, which I believe will help to lift workers throughout the region economically. And that is the type of trade negotiation that we need to do across the board. And as Nisha had pointed out, we have to go back to the table. We can't engage in unilateral trade spats, because the net result is we are the ones that end up with a bloody nose due to countervailing duties and tariffs placed on our products, and our allies and friends end up with the benefit of stealing our business. And this is exactly what was happening with the Chinese trade dispute, by the way. Do we need to be stern with the Chinese with regard to the theft of intellectual property, as well as sticking to multilateral trade agreements and norms? Absolutely. But it's much better when we and our partners are at the table with the Chinese, rather than the president, you know, on a whim imposing duties on them, because what happens is they come back right at our farmers. They come back right at our other small businesses, including in my district. And that has a very, very pernicious effect on our economy. So I think we, the Biden administration, Biden-Harris administration, will hopefully pursue a much more balanced and worker-friendly, environmentally friendly trade policy, but a multilateral one. That's very important.
Congressman Krishnamurthy, I know you have to run, so I just want to say thank you. Those of you that didn't hear, he did say if you have a problem and you're facing challenges in this COVID crisis, please do reach out to his office. But really, really can't tell you how great, A, it is to have you in Congress and representing the South Asian community, but also representing the 8th District in Illinois. We know how much work you're doing in Congress, and we know you're working overtime. So thank you for everything you're doing.
Absolutely. And thank you, Sonal. And thank you to the organizers of this excellent Zoom. I see there are a lot of people who've jumped on. My only parting thought is this. There's an old saying in Washington, D.C., if you don't have a seat at the table, you're on the menu. And we're 19 days away, 38 if you don't sleep. And I'm seeking a contract extension. I know some of my colleagues are, but obviously we need to turn the page. Please vote. And I hope everybody makes a plan and gets their friends and family to do the same. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you.
Nisha, I'm gonna continue on a little bit on the trade. There's always this question that we face in the South Asian community of, are we tough enough on China? Isn't China the bully in the South Asian region? What are we doing differently? And how is the Biden-Harris, how are Democrats actually gonna deal with China?
Well, I think you've heard Vice President Biden talk about this and talk about it in a very compelling way, as well as many of his team focused on foreign policy, Tony Blinken for one. And that is that the first thing America needs to do is to be strong domestically and to be strong globally, to reanimate and reinvigorate our alliances and partnerships. And so if you want to be able to show strength with China, you have to be able to back that up with your economic strength, with your geopolitical strength. And I think the criticism that I've heard most effective is the fact that America stands alone on so many of these critical questions right now, because we have frayed our relationships with some of our closest and oldest partners. So that's issue number one. Issue number two is, you know, China is an important actor on the global stage. We want that actor to act with respect and within the norms and rules that we have invested in for so many decades. America has paid with blood and sweat in upholding a rules-based order since post-World War II. It is shocking to me that that in many ways, actors like Russia and China have often worked to undermine that rules-based order and have tried to act in hegemonic ways. And yet in the current administration, we've seen the United States itself, the White House, walk away from those core tenets and principles. And so a Biden administration would work very closely with partners like India, which has been a strong proponent of extending those international norms. What we want to do is ensure that we create a world order where might does not make right, where you have an ability for countries to coexist and to be able to operate within agreed upon norms. And you've seen very aggressive and assertive behavior by China. You've seen that in terms of the India-China relationship, but you've seen that also in its relationship with smaller countries across the Indo-Pacific. And I think it is because it is sensing a power vacuum, and it has stepped into that power vacuum, and it has felt like it can act with impunity. So I think a Biden administration will work very quickly to re-strengthen our alliances and to ensure that we are building a global consensus on the types of behaviors that are acceptable.
Yeah. And Nisha, with that, I also want to bring in Shashi Bluchwar here. He is the CEO of the Institute for Transformative Technology, where they're really working on technology to combat global poverty. He's an expert on international development, a professor at Berkeley. We randomly were at an event together, I believe in Europe, and I can't even remember where, Shashi, at this point, but it was very funny when we made the connection that we knew each other at the event. So it's great to have you here and bring you in on this conversation on why the international alliances matter. You're an expert on this. You've been working on this for much of your career. Tell us what we've done. Like, what has the U.S. done in the last 4 years in walking away? And what has that meant?
You know, so we met, it was actually just an hour or so away from where the Paris Climate accord was hashed out. You know, so as you mentioned, I work in global poverty alleviation, typically in developing countries, South Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. And one of the things that's given me a really, really strong appreciation for is strong and accountable institutions, right? You know, Nisha was mentioning that the world order today, it was built over decades since the Second World War. And when they work well, and you know, they're imperfect, but when they work, they ensure a certain stability, a certain security, equity, and just a level of predictability so we can just go about our day-to-day business, right? Go about trade and so on. So that's how economies get created, not through volatility, but a certain degree of slow, stable, good stuff happening, right? Now, historically, Republicans have disinvested in institutions. And one clear way it manifests itself in not just economic policy, but environmental policy and so on and so forth, is just massive levels of deregulation. And when institutions are weakened, it makes the system more vulnerable to shocks. And also it becomes very hard to recover from the shocks, right? So I came to the US in the late 80s. And since then, you know, so George H.W. Bush got elected after I came to this country, you know, and Bill Clinton won on the mantra of it's the economy stupid, right? So it took years to build back up from after the first Bush administration. Then after George W. Bush came into office, there was a massive level of deregulation. And we saw the outcome of that, the global financial crisis, right? It just took the global economy down with it. And with the great work that President Obama and Vice President Biden did after many, many years, things got built back up, right? And then what did Trump do? He not only, he delegitimized and decimated institutions. And the classic example of that is the WHO. Yeah, and so there have been threats of pandemics like COVID in the past. So in 2003, there was the original SARS outbreak. In 2013, 14, 15, there was the West African Ebola outbreak, right? But by working closely with the WHO, with international partners, with other countries, you know, we were able to, as a global community and as the American community, stop that, right? But when Trump defunds the WHO, doesn't take good advice from people who've been through this before, you see the effect of that. So, and this is gonna take a long time to recover from, right? So it's not just the economic devastation of COVID, but he's also, you know, as Nisha was saying earlier, right? A part of what he's doing is legitimizing autocracies, plutocracies, kleptocracies, right? Just a level of corruption that you don't associate with American governments. You know, those of us who worked internationally in South Asia, for instance, we know how hard it can be to grow businesses and grow economies. Yeah. There's so much corruption around, right? So this is not just about formal bad news of Trump. Right? This is about the decades of recovery it'll take if these institutions need to be decimated. We simply cannot afford that.
Yeah, and you know, Shashi, I want to just pick up on a couple of things you said here. One, I'd like to just, if you could amplify this a little bit more. Why does it matter that the U.S. is sitting at that table? You mentioned it about the WHO. You've mentioned it about all of your work in other countries. Why does it matter when the U.S. is there?
You know, for all our imperfections, America has actually been a beacon. You know, every day now, you know, we work on sort of COVID response globally, right? Not a day goes by when people, some of whom have barely come to America, right? But they are depressed about what's happening to global order. Right? The US has been seen as the global leader since the Second World War. And now that leadership is missing and that void is being taken up by just utter chaos. Right? Now, you know, China will continue to be the most prominent adversary and they have a way of working. And that explicitly rules out human rights, protection of the environment, and just a grab for extractives, which actually decimates local economies, right? So, and again, for all the criticisms of how the US has operated in the past, it has been seen as this stable beacon around which the world has rallied. And that's the reason we're on the table.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. And with that, that's a great comment to bring in Priya Sridharan, who is an expert on climate And she has been working with USAID in India in solving environmental and energy problems. She's built public partnerships. She's worked with the Lawrence Berkeley Labs. She's worked with the EPA. She's worked with the Academy of Sciences. She brings a depth of experience into this. And Priya, I'd like to bring you into this conversation. You know, Shashi mentioned environmental deregulation. He's mentioned sort of why the US presence matters in making sure that we're sort of collectively working at something. So tell me a little bit about the Biden-Harris administration globally working on climate. I met with Shashi not that far away from the Paris Climate Agreement. Tell us why this matters and why having South Asia at the table with the United States matters.
Yeah, absolutely. Climate change, I think for those of you who may not, I think the number of folks who question whether climate change is real, whether it will have a devastating economic impact is shrinking. But I just want to remind us all, if you just look at the impact of the hurricanes and storms and wildfires, we're looking at, and this is estimated by the government's Congressional Budget Office, we're looking at about annual cost of $55 billion a year plus. So by not tackling climate change, you know, we're already putting our economy at risk. Now, what's really fascinating is by tackling climate change, you're actually creating economic opportunities and development. And there are sort of two aspects. One aspect was that you've asked about is the Biden and Harris ticket's approach towards climate change and in the US. And then the other part being why that matters on a global front. I'll just share on a domestic front, my organization, current organization actually, which is Grid Lab, it's based in the US, it had looked at what would it take to actually tackle climate change in the power sector, because, you know, no more do we have this sort of, you know, scenario where clean energy technologies are expensive. We've seen this massive cost declines in solar generation and batteries. And what we actually found out when we did this analysis is that it's technically feasible, it's relatively cost effective, and in fact, we would see lower prices in the future than today. Not just that, we would also see development of jobs. Up to about 10 million is what we estimated. I personally think it's actually more because it goes beyond just the basic nuts and bolts construction, operation, and maintenance jobs. We're really talking about a revolution in how we can modernize the power sector. And that means the sort of merging of information technology and energy technology. So this is actually going to have a profound impact on the kinds of opportunities our children, our grandchildren will have. Why does this matter globally? Well, in case folks may not be aware, actually India, other countries in South Asia are already on board. They've signed on to the Paris Agreement. Prime Minister Modi's national solar mission actually has a fairly aggressive goal of reaching 175 plus gigawatts of solar and wind energy. And you know what? These countries, and I know this from firsthand experience working overseas, they look to the US for leadership on how to do this. They look to our experience with our national labs, with our private sector firms, with the innovation that comes out of Silicon Valley. They are counting on what we bring in order for them to also modernize, for them to develop their energy sector, because that is actually one of the prerequisites for economic development. So US leadership is incredibly important. And earlier we were talking about China, and I will add that strengthening energy cooperation, the US can play a role in that by sort of providing this neutral leadership, technical assistance role. And by strengthening South Asia through enhancing energy development, you're making the rest of Asia stronger. And that's actually one of the best ways to counteract the influence of China. Make the rest of Asia, you know, strong in what they do. And that's another, I would say, strategy of tackling that particular influence.
In the Biden-Harris plan, I believe they talk a lot about investing in research and putting significant amount of research money into climate technologies. Can you talk us a little bit about like what that means for U.S. businesses, for business globally?
Oh, absolutely. And let me just start off that with the sort of caveat that, well, two caveats. One, I am not representing the campaign. And secondly, though there are a number of research opportunities, I do want to emphasize that we have technologies today already that will definitely set us on a very important course. Now, there's still a lot of innovation that needs to happen. And through that research and development innovation, which a lot of that does, and not all of it, but certainly the role of Silicon Valley, and now we're seeing a lot of, you know, these innovations and in different technologies come up all over the country. The establishment of ARPA-E, which is like a DARPA, but for energy, which was created under the Obama administration, has done amazing work there. I'll give you one example. There was a technology that came out of Georgia Tech through an ARPA-E grant that was then parlayed into a commercialized technology called Smart Wires, which enables us to use transmission. Sorry, I'm getting a little wonky, but enables us to use transmission capacity smartly. So this is doing things smartly instead of with brute force. Now, they have had tremendous interest all over the world in this technology, in Australia, in India. Some of the grid operators that I have worked with, had the privilege of working with, are also quite intrigued with this technology. So the sort of ripple effect you see from R&D cannot be exaggerated, you know, and I feel like the contributions the U.S. has made through its national labs, through its universities, for example, in developing solar panels and improving the technology, we are now, the whole world is reaping the benefits that have come from that investment in innovation.
You know, Priya, I promise I haven't planned these great transitions that you all are setting me up for. So with that, I'm going to bring in Tamina Watson. She is, you know, sort of everything you're talking about also requires immigration, and the people that work in our national labs are in many cases coming from the South Asian region, and why this matters. Tamina, you are a force of nature. You have, you've written a book, you see the book behind you, Legal Heroes. You're an author, you run your own law firm. You're an immigration lawyer by background. You had a radio show, you have a podcast. You're sort of like somebody I wish I could be, but I will never be. So appreciate everything that you are doing. But talk to us a little bit, you're on mute by the way too. Talk to us a little bit about what's going on with our immigration policy in the United States, and what has the last 4 years done to immigration from South Asia?
Well, Sonal, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And of course, you know, I admire every single person here. Before I talk about the last 4 years, I want to say something before I forget. It's something I tell my clients all the time. A lot of people are stuck in their naturalization applications and they cannot vote. And there's a lot of anxiety about, oh my gosh, I cannot vote. And what I want to remind people is that you are an influencer. You know, you have colleagues and family members who can vote. You have a voice, make sure you use it. Get out the vote is absolutely for those who can vote, but if you cannot vote because you're stuck in this immigration maze I'm about to tell you about, you can do something about it. So make sure your voice is heard. The economic agenda that everybody's talked about so far is so nicely integrated into immigration, whether it's trade, foreign policy, and climate change, all of these things. And just to give a background to how the economy is affected by immigrants, in 2018, immigrants contributed almost $500 million into the tax system. And of that, in 2015, those without social security numbers contributed $23.6 billion into the economy. There's a lot of money that immigrants bring to the economy, and if they are not strategically used, we're not going to be able to get out of this systematic problem that's been created by this administration, compounded by a pandemic that has now got 40 million plus people out of work. So immigration really has to be part of the agenda 100%. You know, in 2009, when I started my firm, it was a recession. And at the time, people, a lot of them from South Asian communities, particularly from the Indian community, said, well, I just want to start my law firm. I'm sorry, my business. How can I do that when I don't have a job? I just got laid off from Microsoft or Amazon or wherever they were. And if you're going to start a business, those come with job creation. Immigrants are hardworking job creators, and that has to be absolutely understood. So the last 4 years have been the opposite of what the Biden-Harris team will likely do. And I would encourage people to look at my book. It is a compilation of what lawyers have had to do over the last 4 years in protecting the rule of law, but also trying to make sure we uphold what the law says on immigration. So if I had to summarize in 4 words what the last 4 years have been like, there's been fear-mongering, inhumanity, inefficiencies, and the creation of an invisible wall that becomes higher and higher by the month. And so what happened, you know, we had the rhetoric of the campaign trail of immigrants are not good, you know, they are drug dealers and rapists and you name it, you know. And when the election was, I say, lost, a lot of people thought it wouldn't be as bad. You know, he just did it to, you know, win the election. But as soon as Trump got into office, we saw executive order after executive order after executive order. And people might remember that the Wednesday after the inauguration, there was the 2 executive orders that were the Interior Enforcement and Border Security that had the ramification of what we saw later with separation of parents and so forth. A lot of this is in the news. I'm going to talk about some of the nitty gritty in a minute. But what we saw in April 2017 was the Buy American, Hire American executive order. And that actually was written rather simply. When it came to immigration, it said, we shall hire the brightest minds and the highest paid. And when I first saw that, I thought, well, that's rather simple. Congress needs to set the boundaries for what that should mean. So I didn't necessarily feel as worried. Except June 2017 comes along and our H-1Bs start to see these ridiculous RFEs, requests for evidence, to show that somebody is actually eligible for these H-1Bs. And what followed soon thereafter, and this is what affects our South Asian community the most, and the Indian community particularly, is that we had seen the highest denials of H-1Bs. Now, H-1Bs are used by businesses. They're not, you know, individuals don't apply for them. But these businesses have to spend a lot of money to hire workers. They wouldn't do that if they had local workers. And so the administration here has, in an effort to cut off the nose, they're actually spiting the face, because it's not just about the South Asian communities or immigrant communities. It's about businesses, American businesses that are generating jobs and contributing to the economy. And so I'm going to talk about 2 particular things because there's so much I could talk about. But what has happened to our South Asian community particularly, we care about our family values and we care about our education that leads to our jobs. So economic stimulus for our businesses as well as family values. When it comes to family values, the government has instituted something called public charge. The public charge is about saying, hey, you immigrants, if you come here, we want to see that you can be self-sufficient. Well, there were already measures on that, but these rules that have come in have really just been designed to deny cases. And they went into effect just before COVID started in February 24th, 2020, after a lot of litigation. And these are going to essentially affect the way family immigration gets approved for siblings and parents and so forth. And when it comes to businesses, particularly on the H-1B, what you hear as rhetoric actually gets affected into what we see in cases. So when there's a rhetoric, oh my gosh, there are 40 million people out of jobs, and you have one executive order after another in just the last 3-4 months, those actually get reflected in the paperwork we see in our offices. So for example, we were doing a training visa for somebody, and the rhetoric basically said to me that it all boiled down to, you are displacing an American worker. And I looked around, it was so new, I was gobsmacked. And I found one lawyer who had just received a denial 3 days earlier. And it basically boiled down to, it doesn't matter what you say in the evidence you provide, they're going to do what they're going to do. And a lot of things you hear in the news, one small tweaks you don't hear in the news. So there was something that was instituted about biometrics in these types of cases, in certain types of cases, which were not necessary before. In one fell swoop, the backlog is so long that you'll, who knows when we'll get those actually approved, if at all. And in the meantime, with these inefficiencies, the administration says, oh no, USCIS doesn't have enough money anymore. We're going to furlough 70% of our folks. And then suddenly when Congress starts looking for accountability, suddenly say, well, we have some money, we can stretch it out to October. So the last 4 years have been just a topsy-turvy, upside down, twists and turns of what do we need to do just to get through the day that day.
I think you have, I think you've raised so many points here, and I just want to sort of highlight two points that you're saying, which is every rule that has come out from these immigration policies have been meant to stop immigration. And that includes family immigration. It's making it harder for families to get here. Somebody had a question about that, and the backlog has only grown. And it's important that people remember that that we recognize that. Second, somebody had a question about official calls from the US government, largely emanating from India. I just want everybody to know everybody listening, the US government will never call you. They will send you a letter. You will not get a call if there's something wrong with your Social Security, if there's something wrong with your immigration files. They will send you a letter. Please do not believe anything, any phone call you get, do not believe it, because the government does not call you. Trust me, I have been a victim of identity theft, and I know that the US government sends me letters. They do not call you. So just keep that in mind. I know that question was in there. I want to bring in Reshma Saujani into here, another force of nature. She has been an incredible leader in our community, in the South Asian community. She was the first South Asian woman to run for Congress out of New York. Girls Who Code, focused on really changing the face and make of technology. Who's coding it? Who's creating it? Who gets access to it. She's an author. She's published two books, Brave but Not Perfect and Girls Who Code. She also has a TED Talk. Reshma, it's so great to have you here. Can you talk to us a little bit about Girls Who Code and what you've seen and why you think it's so important, the work that you are doing in ensuring that girls from every background have the potential to participate?
Yeah, so, you know, Girls Who Code is a movement to close the gender gap in computer science and technology. Less than 20% of the technology workforce is female at a time where almost 40% of America's breadwinners are women. Over the past 8 years, we've taught over 300,000 girls to code, and we've reached about 50 million. So we're one of the largest girls, women's organizations in the world. I think it's so critical that our young girls and our young people learn how to code. I mean, my parents came here as refugees from Uganda. Both of them were engineers, and it was the 1970s, and this country was desperately seeking engineers, and nothing has really changed. We have hundreds of thousands of jobs that are open in technology. We have a workforce that doesn't have the requisite skills to fill those jobs. And if anything, the global health crisis has simply accelerated the automation of so many industries and the need for these skills. I don't know about you, Sonal, but like my father would always have a conversation with me and say, Beta, you have three choices. You can be a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. Because he wanted me to get a good paying job where I can actually, march into the middle class and live the American dream, and all of their sacrifices and everything they've done would have been worth it. And I almost feel like we have to keep having those conversations with our young people today, even more so today, because as President Obama said, like the last jobs to go will be the humans telling the computers what to do. So.
talking to myself on mute again. You've gone around the country, you've talked to families across the country, you have engaged with every community. Tell us why it's important for the South Asian community to engage with the diverse population of the United States, because it's critical that we just don't engage with the South Asian population, but we are part of a larger community here in the US, but globally.
Yeah, I mean, I think when I think about so many of my parents' struggles when they came to this country, they're the struggles of everybody, right? Not knowing the language, trying to fit in. My father changed his name from Mukun to Mike, right? Trying to make sure that their children had every single opportunity in the world and that we could be anything that we wanted to be. And I think that so many people in this country are facing exactly those same challenges. And I think it is so important, you know, for us to be in solidarity with our fellow brothers and sisters that are Black and Latino and Asian American, because we share so many, I think, of the same experiences and discriminations and complexities. I also think, I don't know, I just, look, I love this country. I am a patriot, given the fact that it literally saved my parents' life. And I just feel like we have never been so broken. And I think why all of us are in on this panel, and you know, it's 8 o'clock at night, I got two kids to put to sleep, like, and it's because I wanna heal this broken nation. And I really believe that Biden and Harris will do that. And I really feel like our democracy is on the line. And we gotta do our job and, you know, play our role in making sure that every sacrifice that our parents have sacrificed for us was not in vain.
Yeah, I 100% agree. And I don't think I've ever been as engaged in an election as I am this time. And I've been passionate about a lot of people, but I don't think I've been as engaged, because I do believe democracy is so, so very much on the line. I'm gonna start going through some of the questions, but I think Sunjay's gonna come on and help me with some of the questions, because she's been keeping track of them. But there's one question here, Tamina, this one's actually directed to you. It's about the president has constantly been talking about cutting chain migration, and I put chain in quotes. How can any Indian American vote for anyone other than Biden Harris in light of the constant position against forms of immigration, especially family immigration and sponsorship of siblings and parents and grandparents?
I couldn't agree more. And you know, that was part of the rhetoric until Trump came into office. It wasn't even a term that was, you know, understood or used, but suddenly it's part of our regular vernacular. And he couldn't get it through because Congress wouldn't let him. But the pandemic came and it gave him the tool to do exactly what he had wanted to do for the last 4 years. And so as soon as the pandemic hit, one of the first executive orders was to ban all green cards being issued. And he specifically mentioned parents and siblings. And essentially, he got his wish through the pandemic. A lot of people had their interviews put on hold and canceled, and it's unfortunate that we are in this position. So I absolutely agree with the viewer there. And I would say people, you know, absolutely read my book, because that's a compilation of that. And I want to touch on what Reshma said about refugees. You know, this country, as Shashi said, has been a beacon of light. No matter what the country has done, it's been a beacon of light for and hope for others. But we have had the least number of refugees come into the country, and they keep reducing that. And climate change is going to be a big part of what's going to happen in the future. You know, it's so important that each one of us that are talking, the subject matters are interconnected very, very strongly.
Thank you, Tamina. So Drew, do you want to take on some of these questions?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. What an inspiring, amazing group of speakers. Thank you guys so much. Nisha, there's been a couple of questions about the administration's trade failings and, you know, how we can communicate that better. I mean, what are some tangible impacts of how trade has been handled under this administration?
Well, thank you so much. Look, I think that the American people are starting to understand that just because you use strongman rhetoric doesn't mean that you're actually delivering the results that you're talking about. And we're starting to see that in terms of the responses that we're seeing in the polling numbers and the responses that we're seeing in what Americans are saying. Because frankly, the trade policies of this administration have not worked for the American economy, has not worked for the American worker, has not worked for American small businesses. It hasn't worked for the American farmer. Every one of these categories have seen setbacks. And this is even before COVID. I mean, we can look to how devastating the handling of this pandemic has been on the American economy and on American families. But even before the onset of the pandemic, we were seeing severe economic distress in terms of what the workers were feeling, in terms of what the farmers were feeling. You know, people often look to the stock market and use that as the only metric for a successful economy. And yet, you know, rising stock prices does not necessarily translate into tangible benefits for the average worker. So I think, you know, that message is actually seeping into the electorate, and it's seeping in because we're seeing Americans feeling economic pain at a level that just we haven't seen certainly in our lifetimes.
Thank you so much, Nichelle. So Priya, there's a question for you on how renewable energy support from the US to India could help negate China's dominance in Asia. And I think you did allude to this a bit, but if you could just speak to it in terms of the financial support.
Sure, and actually I just did type in a response in the Q&A. I think the question was specifically on how investment in renewable energy in India would counteract China's military threats, which I don't believe that it can. However, what we are seeing across the globe is that with a vacuum of US leadership in renewable energy investment and lending, et cetera, China has stepped up, and you know, they've done so in ways that are disturbing. And when you start looking at the structures of those loans, so it's very important for many reasons that the US, you know, fill in that leadership role from the R&D to the financing aspect of energy infrastructure, to supporting partnerships and exchanges between researchers across South Asia and within the US.
I've got an example of that, if I may, which is we started a program under the Obama administration's Office of Science and Technology Policy that led to last year. So it involved energy access, right? And our team built a set of technologies for solar mini grids. And last year, working with the Indian government and with the Tata Power and the Rockefeller Foundation, we were able to mobilize $1 billion to electrify 25 million people across 10,000 villages in India, right? You don't see that kind of stuff happening with this administration at all. So again, an example of great leadership under Biden and the Obama presidency.
Yeah, and Shashi, I think you've seen the same thing, right? I mean, where the US is dropping off, China is picking up, especially globally.
Globally, particularly in Africa, that's a whole sort of longer conversation, but we are absolutely seeing that everywhere.
Thank you. So Sonal, there have been a lot of questions that I would say are more foreign policy related, and we're not trying to avoid those. It's just that that's not the folks who we have on this panel. I know many of you, Nisha especially, could speak to a lot of those things, but so we're not avoiding them. They're definitely available on the Biden-Harris website, and they've spoken to a lot of them. But I think Sonal, you might be able to answer this generally. People just have this impression that Trump is good for Indians and India and the Biden administration is not. There's various reasons for that. But I wonder if you could just speak to that just in a general sense.
I'm gonna actually turn that over to Nisha because she was the Assistant Secretary of State for India. And I think she could actually speak better to it because she was the one representing the United States and is now doing this with the US-India Business Council.
Well, thank you, Sonal. And listen, I think once again, you have to be able to look beyond the rhetoric. I think that certainly there have been certain areas where the current administration has done some positive things on the U.S.-India on the U.S.-India front, and certainly the strategic and security partnership has continued to develop. They're building on a very strong foundation that was laid by the Obama administration, where President Obama and Vice President Biden were very engaged throughout their 8 years in office on investing in and building the U.S.-India relationship. It was the first state dinner that President Obama hosted when he came into office. He traveled to India twice during his presidency, but he also met with Prime Minister Modi probably about 8 times during his tenure. And we had every cabinet official in the Obama administration developing deep, strong, broad-based strategic ties. What I would say with this administration is that while there has been a focus on the security relationship, so many other aspects of the partnership have not been advanced in the same way. You haven't had, the health dialogue that existed in the Obama administration, the higher education dialogue that existed previously. We haven't seen kind of the broad science and technology partnership that we, had launched in the prior administration. And I think a Biden administration will look to a U.S.-India relationship that is broad-based, that we will certainly continue to see India as a critically important strategic and security partner, but we will want to see a stronger economic partnership between the two countries. We will want to see the people-to-people ties, the higher education partnership, and all of the state-to-state relationships right now that are just blossoming as more and more Indian states and American states are also reaching out across to each other in ways to facilitate that. So I think what you will see is a Biden administration taking a much more holistic and broad focus on India, looking at climate partnership, looking at the COVID pandemic and how a health collaboration between our two countries can address some of the challenges that the U.S., India, and frankly, global challenges.
That's great. Thank you so much. Sonal, is there anything else that you had? I know you wanted to ask one last question of all the panelists.
I do want to ask one last question, and largely because I do think that we have to leave on a sense of hope, but also talk about why it's so important. Personally, it is for me that Kamala Harris is our vice presidential nominee, why it is so incredible that a South Asian woman who comes from immigrant parents, both of her parents were immigrants, and is now sitting at the top of a presidential ticket in the United States in just one generation. What does it mean for our community, and what does it mean to each of you personally? Actually, I would make this a personal question to each of you, and why does it matter? Shashi, can I start with you?
Yeah, sure. I mean, look, what makes America unique and what makes America America is that people from everywhere congregate here, make this their home, right? And in many ways, America represents global citizenship. And I can't think of a better human being than Kamala Harris to do that.
Nisha?
So, so many of us have been told at some point or the other in our lives, in our jobs, in our communities or, interactions, well, you're not a real American. We've heard this, right? And we've internalized it sometimes. We've had to push back against it. Here you have Kamala Harris, a daughter of immigrants, someone who embodies kind of the American dream and embodies the opportunity that the United States represents. It embodies how America is unique, is different, is actually a society that is built on the hopes and aspirations of people from all over the world who see in America that ability to, you know, live a better life, but also create a better world. And so she speaks to that in all of us. And that's just a powerful, powerful representation.
Priya?
Yeah, I agree with everything everyone has said so far. And to me, it's, you know, it's not really just the story of Kamala Harris. It's the story of her family that makes me really excited. Her mother actually was a researcher at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and was a good friend of my dance teacher who lives in Berkeley. Kamala Harris's niece studied Bharatanatyam with many of us here. So for me, it really is, you know, this is the quintessential American story. You know, the story of acceptance, the story of working hard and being successful, the story of giving back to your community, which she has done over and over. And to me, that is what, you know, symbolizes the, you know, what being a citizen really is. And I agree completely that, you know, this is also sort of an endorsement of accepting that if you're brown skinned, you know, America's racial dialogue is so much really about black and white, and understandably, but, you know, the story of what Indian Americans and others can contribute is an important one. And so I think there's so many different dimensions to her story that make me very proud and very inspired on a personal level.
Tamina?
What everybody said, I agree 110%. What this election means to me, this is my adopted country, if you haven't tuned into my accent. But I, when I was applying for citizenship for all my other clients, I never really understood how profoundly it affects oneself until I had my own citizenship application approved. And I write about it in the Seattle Times if anybody wants to read that, but it's essentially about what it means to be an American. You know, I felt like it was a rebirth. I want America to be the best that it can be. I want it to be the beacon of hope that it always has been. I want it to be a hopeful place for my children. I have two daughters, 8 and 10, and they will aspire to seeing the first Vice President Kamala Harris who looks like them. And I think that's every one of us. So I hope people will go out and vote. Tell your friends and family to vote. We need this election to really count because it's the turning point of this country.
And I wanna just close, Sanjay, before I turn it back over to you. Just a reminder, this panel was about the US and this conversation. And for many of our colleagues who are friends who have joined us who are South Asian, I know we could have talked about foreign policy and other things, but really this election, as you are hearing from all of us, for all of us is about what is happening in the United States and what is the role of the United States and how can the US sort of become the beacon in the world again and what it means to do that. And for all of us, it means that the acceptance of us as Americans being able to live in this country, work in this country, survive in this country, thrive in this country, giving, making it available for all of our next generation that's coming. That's what this election is about. We can talk about foreign policy. Foreign policies are dramatically not that different from every administration, but what is important and what is on the table is democracy. And that's what this is about. And this is, we can talk about the economy, but this is about democracy. Are we the democracy in the world that's gonna work with everybody else or are we not? So Sanjay, I'm gonna turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Sonal. You could not have said it better. That's a wonderful note for us to end this on. You've been a fabulous moderator. Thank you to our wonderful panelists. Thank you to Congressman Krishnamurthy and to Reshma Sojani, who had to leave slightly early. This has been presented to you by South Asians for Biden. Rohit and I, I'm Sanjay Kumar, by the way, never said my name. We are from the Georgia chapter of South Asians for Biden. And we are fighting like heck every day here. We have a lot of work to do, 2 Senate seats and the presidency and all the way down the line. But one thing we just wanna mention to you, we're gonna put it up on the screen before we go, is South Asians for Biden conducts phone banking every week in all the swing states, and we target South Asian voters. It's been highly effective. We encourage you to join us. We're also selling some fabulous Kamala t-shirts on our website. So please go to South Asians for Biden for t-shirts as well. But thank you so much for joining us today. This has been a wonderful substantive conversation, and we appreciate you all joining us. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Bye.